Hi, thank you for joining me for this video. Join your hearts with me in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Jonah, the book of Jonah, changed the way you look at God in the world. This is not a story about fishing. It's not so much a story about a large fish who swallowed a reluctant prophet. It's not even so much a story about Jonah learning how to accept God's call in his life, but it's a story about God challenging us to in terms of how we understand and look at God and how we look at the world, in terms of how we look at ourselves even. Consider this. Everybody in this story is religious. Read the book. If you haven't read the book, we've only read just a small part of it. Thank you, Rick, for reading it. We've only read a small part of it. The book isn't very long. It doesn't take very long to read, but it's an incredible book. Examine the characters in the story, the sailors. Everybody in this story is religious. As they encounter this sudden storm that threatens to drown all of them and claim all of their lives, each of the sailors cries out to his own God for help in the storm. The captain goes down to the hull of the ship where Jonah is asleep. Makes me think of Jesus sleeping in the boat. Jonah is asleep and unconcerned about anybody because he's just running from God, doesn't have a care in the world. The captain wakes him up because he's concerned about everybody. The people of Nineveh quickly hear and respond with repentance. They are religious too. They demonstrate their repentance how? Through fasting and through sackcloth. What's sackcloth like? It's a scratchy, itchy cloth that's very uncomfortable to wear. It was what they wore to show visibly their repentance, their change of heart. It's a visible sign of saying, I'm sorry. Even the king commands that no one, human or animal, should eat, and that even the animals, along with the humans, should wear sackcloth. That's how intent they were on showing their repentance. They were religious, very religious. They were listening to God and responding to God's voice. Think about that. That's pretty important in this story. Everybody in this story is religious. Consider this. Everybody in the story, the sailors, are more humane and more generous and kind in how they treat other people than Jonah is. Jonah is sullen and angry. Jonah is concerned that God would forgive those vile, evil people of Nineveh. The sailors, even though they don't know anything about Jonah, and they discover that he's the one that's responsible for this miserable plight that they're in, their ship almost ready to flounder and go down into the sea, and all of them drown, they show kindness to Jonah. They discover that he's the one who's responsible. They hear Jonah say that he's a Hebrew and that he worships the God, the Lord, who created heaven and earth, the sea and the dry land. And they are overwhelmed with amazement that Jonah would be so foolish and stupid as to try to run away from that God. They're more clever than Jonah is. And yet, when Jonah says, the only way you're going to save yourselves is to throw me overboard, they don't want to throw him overboard. They try everything they can. They try desperately hard to row back to land. When the sea, the storm intensifies even more, Jonah says, throw me overboard. They pray to this newfound God, the Lord who created the sea and the dry land, and they say, we don't want to do this, but you're the one that brought on this storm because of this guy, Jonah. Don't hold us accountable for his blood. And then they threw him over. And then what happened? Once they threw him over, the sea became completely calm. That reminds me of another story where Jesus was asleep in the boat. And Jesus calmed the storm, and it became calm instantly. They throw Jonah overboard, the storm ceases, and the sea becomes calm, and Jonah sinks into the water. But Jonah is swallowed by a large fish. Note what the sailors do. once that happens, they offer up a sacrifice, probably a sacrifice of thanksgiving and a sacrifice of saying, we're humble and we're repentant. We're listening to you, God. And they make vows to this newfound God, their new faith in the Lord who created heaven and earth, the sea and the dry land. They worship that God. Even the king and the citizens of this wicked city fear God, and they respond with appropriate faith. But not Jonah, not Jonah. How does Jonah respond? Jonah, if we were to describe what Jonah is like, he stands alone in his attitude. Contrast his attitude, Jonah's attitude, with the king and with all the other people. Jonah is arrogant. Jonah is selfish. Jonah is narrow-minded. He's a religious bigot. He, in his ministry, he proclaimed in the northern kingdom, in effect, he was saying that God is going to restore us to our former glory. It's almost like I could hear him saying, make Israel great again. Makes me think of something else with our country. Make America great again. America first. Jonah was thinking Israel first, to the point that he excluded anybody and everything else out. And he was angry, not just with the circumstances, but angry that God would be willing to forgive these wicked people. He even elevated himself above God. He wanted God to be like him. He wanted to instruct and teach God. Oh, what a dangerous man. That's why this story, if you're thinking it's just a story about Jonah and the whale, if you're thinking it's just a story about hearing God's voice and responding to God's call to you to ministry, you're missing the point. The story is about God challenging our worldview. Learn how to have God's heart. Learn to see people the way God sees people. Learn to embrace people the way God embraces people. And not just people, but animals as well. Think of this, the last verse. If I can find where I put the last verse. Should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 people who do not know their right hand from their left hand, and also many animals? God's love is much broader, much wider, much deeper than you and I can imagine. And God is saying, I want you to embrace me and the way I look at people. Don't you tell me who I should love and who I shouldn't love. Don't you tell me what I should limit myself to. But learn to have God's heart and care for people the way God cares for people. What a great story this is. If you haven't listened or read Psalm 62, take time to read that again too. Because again, it says God alone is our rock and our salvation. Join your hearts with me in prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you for joining me.